Hello, and welcome to today's economic update. We'll be taking a look at the COVID-19 outbreak, its impact on the market, and the opportunities that the current climate brings. I'd like to introduce our two speakers today, Justin Fisk, Senior Vice President of Investment at Sheridan Road Financial, a division of Hub International, and Chris Karam, CEO of Karam Capital Consulting. Chris, I'll let you take it away.
Thank you, Sarah. The goals of these webcasts are to one, inform investors of current economic and market conditions, second, make sense of how global events interconnect and impact your money, and three, do so in an efficient manner and be respectful of your time. So let's get started. Today we have five areas of focus. Not surprisingly, first, we will start with the story of the year, the COVID-19 outbreak and the economic impact of social distancing. Second, we'll move on to the importance of plunging oil prices. Third, we will discuss the unprecedented government response to the virus breakout. Fourth, we'll cover some of the economic recession indicators and how to recover. And fifth, we wish to highlight the opportunities developing as we invest in a bear market. Before we get there, it's always helpful to frame current economic and market conditions by reviewing how we got here in the first place. Before COVID-19, we were experiencing 2% plus economic growth, with record low unemployment and above inflation wage growth. The exponential spread of the virus encouraged the CDC to recommend strict guidelines of social engagement, triggering an economic recession and massive and rapid unemployment. This resulted in poor market results, extremely high levels of equity market volatility, and local communities setting their own rules for battling the spread. Over the last couple of weeks, you've become familiar with these curve charts of how the number of COVID-19 cases around the world have exponentially grown. We are now seeing early indicators of these curves beginning to slow their rates of growth. And we, of course, want the number of recoveries to rise while deaths to decline. Here in the United States, social distancing was required given the contagiousness of the virus. And densely populated cities like New York City and densely populated states like New Jersey have been the hardest hit. The impact of social distancing is taking its toll on our economy, our labor market, and on corporate earnings. Consumer spending is the biggest driver of economic growth, and it has diminished in key sectors like traditional retail sales, restaurants and bars, entertainment, tourism, and transportation. Collectively, these sectors accounted for 19% of GDP in 2019, 20% of all payroll jobs, and 7% of S&P 500 operating earnings. Social distancing may be good for the public health, but has impaired our economic strength. The economic weakness sent the number of weekly jobless claims off the chart. The last two weekly reports tallied nearly 10 million unemployed, while we normally have a few hundred thousand claims in a typical weekly report prior to the COVID-19 outbreak. The April 3rd jobs report released by the Bureau of Labor Statistics indicated the leisure and hospitality sector was the hardest hit, with over 450,000 jobs lost in the month of March. Other service sectors hit hard were healthcare, business services, and retail trades. The demand for oil, given the lack of overall economic activity, plummeted and caused certain countries to engage in a high-stakes dispute that further exacerbated volatile equity markets. Russia and Saudi Arabia have not seen eye to eye on several geopolitical matters, which recently spilled over into the oil markets. On March 11, the Saudis decided to increase oil production by 1 million barrels a day during a time of declining demand. Oil prices correspondingly plummeted below $20 per barrel on March 29th, and they began the year at over $60 a barrel. This is problematic because the United States is now a net exporter of oil, and we have a robust shale oil industry, which is usually more profitable when crude oil prices are in the $40+ per barrel range. Most recently, as of Sunday, April 12th, the OPEC Plus countries agreed to a record production cut of 9.7 million barrels per day in order to stabilize prices. As these global events unfolded, it became clear that policymakers had to act boldly in order to calm the markets. Both the Federal Reserve and Congress acted accordingly. The Federal Reserve cut short-term interest rates in two emergency 50 basis point moves to a near zero interest rate target. The Fed also expanded their balance sheet with further monetary easing to accommodate liquidity needs in the credit markets. The Fed acted quickly and forcefully and used their experience during the 2008-2009 financial crisis to try to prevent another credit crisis from occurring. Congress also got in the act by passing a $2.2 trillion fiscal relief package, which included direct payments to individual taxpayers, a small business lending initiative, and loan guarantees to businesses participating in economic sectors hit the hardest. The amount of the fiscal relief is nearly equivalent to 10% of our overall economic output. Other countries are following suit with their own relief programs, similar to the one structured here in the United States. And now for additional results and to talk about opportunities, I'll turn it over to Justin.
Thanks, Chris. Now that we've seen the underlying drivers for the quarter, I'll pivot the conversation to year-to-date results. This slide shows S&P 500 intra-year declines and calendar year returns since 1980. It's important to note that this data is through the end of the first quarter. Looking at the data all the way to the right, we see that the S&P 500 experienced an intra-quarter decline of 34%, but the return for the quarter improved, relatively speaking, to negative 20%. Also of note on this slide is that the average intra-year drop is nearly 14%, but annual returns were positive in 30 of the last 40 years, highlighting the value of a long-term perspective. Next, we see the familiar quilt presentation of asset class returns. If we focus on the year-to-date results in the third column from the right, we see fixed income leading the way with a return of 3.1%. The asset allocation portfolio at 55% equity is down nearly 15% for the quarter, but experienced diversification benefits versus large caps, which were down 19.6%, international developed markets down 22.7%, international emerging markets down 23.6%, and small caps, which finished the quarter down over 30%. Having reviewed asset class returns, another key question is the current risk of recession, which we see on the next slide. This slide shows the ClearBridge Investments Recession Risk Dashboard, which is composed of 12 variables across the following categories: financial, inflation, consumer, and business activity. In the left-hand column of data, we see that the current overall indicator at the bottom signals red, pointing to increased probability of a looming recession. One item to note here is that the money supply is currently in the green, in contrast to historical recessions in the U.S. since 1969. This reinforces the fiscal and monetary response information that Chris shared earlier. We will continue to share this dashboard to gauge recession risk, but that begs another question. If we now expect recession, when can we expect recovery? We now move to the U.S. Recession Recovery Dashboard, also from ClearBridge Investments. This dashboard is comprised of 9 variables reflecting economic and financial conditions, along with consumer, investor, and business confidence. Along the bottom of the chart, we see the months from a green signal to the end of the last 7 recessions, ranging from green 6 months before the end of the recession in 1970 to green 2 months after the end of the recession in 1982. The current overall signal is red, indicating that the pieces are not yet in place to support a durable recovery, but we will continue to monitor and report this information. The last topic I'd like to discuss are some potential opportunities in international equities and fixed income. This slide shows performance of the S&P 500, representing domestic equities, and the MSCI All-Country World ex-US, representing international equities. The first noticeable element of this chart is the divergence of domestic and international equities around the 2012 timeframe. Next to highlight are the decreases in both charts for March 31st, 2020, echoing the asset class return data shared earlier. Third, the table shows price-to-earnings ratios versus the 20-year average for each index, with the S&P 500 at 15.4 times earnings versus an average of 15.5, and the MSCI ACWI ex-US at 12.3 times earnings versus an average of 13.6. This may indicate relative opportunity in international markets. Finally, on the next slide, we see credit spreads for corporate credit, with each line representing the additional yield over treasuries by credit rating. Spreads are currently at levels not seen since 2016, indicating that opportunities may exist for fixed income investors. It's important to note that we advocate that investors maintain discipline and use a diversified strategic asset allocation, including risk exposures that are appropriate for their situation. With that, I'll turn it over to Sarah to wrap up.
Thanks, Justin. We hope that you've found this information valuable and feel better informed about the activity in the markets and its potential impact to your investments. If you're looking for additional insight into navigating the current coronavirus crisis, our Coronavirus Resource Center at hubinternational.com has the latest information, guidance, and resources to help you, your families, and your business. We'll be hosting additional webinars in the future around what's going on with the pandemic and your investments. The best way to make sure you receive invitations to webinars like this in the future and notifications on videos is to subscribe to communications by texting HUB to 888-111. Thank you for your time. This ends our webinar today.